You came here in 1983 mm-hmm. and got a full scholarship from Berklee College of Music.
That's right, that's right. It was a very nice moment in my life, obviously. It felt this is the most radiant place, Berklee, when I got here, because I found such an inspiring environment. Lots of great right. student musicians, lots of great teachers. And even though at that point I was coming off the road, I was traveling in Europe with several professional bands who asked me originally after they heard me at the conservatory and then heard me on subsequent tours. But I felt I have to get back to school
right.
because I want to become deeper as a composer and then as an improviser. I don't want to turn into a session musician who is just right. jack of all trades kind of
right.
situation,
yeah.
which happens you know, when you are on the road with so many different groups and the necessity of being in the scene
right.
Was to be just versatile but not going that deep. And once I got here, that happened real quick. I reconnected right. to that depth that originally inspired me
right.
To be a musician and started to compose, and my improvisational style became very original and unique to me. So I felt, okay, now I speak with the voice I always knew I had.
Right. Yeah. And you did something for a college recording that you mm-hmm. did with Ian Fruman, a drummer
yeah,
from Canada,
yeah.
Tommy Smith from Scotland, and mm-hmm. I forget
what. Terje Gevelt, who's a bass player
bass
from
player.
Norway. He's very
yeah.
good, actually. He's, he went on to play with Billy Cobham and a lot of people. And everybody else in that band did very well, but we were all students.
Yes.
And the idea for that band was coming kind of out of my earlier trio, which was with Aaron Scott on drums, who later went on to play with McCoy Tyner. Aaron
right.
was a student at the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And a Japanese bass player, a very creative one named Stomu Takeishi, who later went on to play with Paul Motion and
yeah.
Henry Treadgill
oh, yeah.
and
yeah.
a lot of other people. So we had the trio and we just improvised. And the members of Forward Motion heard those trio performances and they felt that this is the way to go. And I always felt that because I got to music in such a natural way, got to play in such a natural way, I was able to inspire the people I got together
yeah.
to open up and really trust their talent and be there in the moment.
Right.
And these guys just went with it right away. So that concert,
yeah.
which ended up to be our first album for the Hap label,
yeah.
just as a student band. That was practically improvised on a few chord changes that could be fit on a napkin.
Right, yeah. And then you did another recording for them, right?
Yep. Yes, yes. We did another recording at the Rainbow Studio in
Norway.
Norway.
The famous Rainbow
the famous
Studio.
Famous Rainbow Studio yeah. over ACM
yeah.
Records.
Yeah.
Recorded most of their releases for Keith Jarrett and everybody else. And that was a great experience in the studio, but I really felt that our first album, which was just recorded off the board at the Berklee
right.
Performance Center,
yep.
that was the rawest, that was the most amazing music that band was able to produce. Actually,
right.
as a matter of fact, I remembered my first connection with the great Dave Liebman, saxophonist, was that he was visiting Berklee as a, you know, gave master classes as a visiting professor, and I caught him in the hallway and gave him a cassette of that performance even before it came out as an album. And he listened to it and then he called me up, which is an honor, you know, you are a student, basically a nobody.
Right.
And Dave Liebman calls you up and says, man, you know how to deal, how you know how to play. I really like this recording. And then I was able to call him later for being guest artist with my bands,
yeah,
which really helps a lot when somebody of that,
caliber
yeah, plays
sure.
your music.
Absolutely.
You learn so much from that experience that
right.
you project something
right.
that they are interested in, and what you get
right.
back is invaluable.
Yeah. And then you did two with a company called Antilia Records,
mm-hmm.
which is part of Chrysalis Records, I guess, Island Records. It's a whole,
I don't know if the Chrysalis
it was a whole,
is part of it, but maybe you were right.
A whole division.
Mm-hmm.
Island had Chrysalis and other things.
Yeah, I think.
And you did Tsunami?
Everybody says that now. It's actually the legend of Tsumi, which is a little nickname we gave to our son, based on a magical character in a Hungarian folk legend about somebody who spreads love around, and it's a magical little person. And prior to that, I released The Secret.
Yeah, and that's one secret.
One secret. You remember from last time? Yeah, because there are some albums, secrets. I think Herbie has one, but this was just the secret. And that recording got me the record deal. So first we made the actual recording. Also, Ian Froman on drums and Miroslav Itus, great, unbelievable musician.
Who was one of the founding members of Weather Report.
And played with Chick Corea on some seminal records.
Yeah.
So he was on it, and again we did it. I wrote tunes for that, and I wrote very specific things, but we did it in 7 hours in the studio, live to two track, like recording a concert, no mixing or anything involved after that. That's what it is. And Antilles Records picked it up, and then they gave me a chance to record another one, which I invited Dave Holland.
Dave Holland, great, the legendary player.
Right, right. By the time Miroslav was in Europe, he moved over there. So it was a nice opportunity to basically experience another amazing musician playing your music, which was Dave Holland. And after that label folded, so then I, by then I was approached by Sunnyside Records. They were interested in those records. And a few years later, I was able to sign with them and stay with them.
Yeah. Like I said, the last interview we did last year was playing with such great bass players as Maslov and Dave Holland. I mean, they provide you with such a strong foundation of rhythm. And I'm sure, like I said last year, that it teaches you how to use your left hand when you're working with other, particularly bass players are that strong.
Yeah, but you know, it's kind of funny because I learned a lot about that in bands where the bass player wasn't that good.
Yeah, right.
In Europe, you know, I was in the session bands, and sometimes you get together with people that can't really play. So you have to lay down really strong rhythms. And what I found was it was a breeze to play with these guys because everything were where I expected it to be. And I always felt, as you know, I mean, jazz and the jazz scene is not a charitable organization. So everybody plays with people when they feel that there is a mutual opportunity to grow or learn from their experience. So I really felt in all of those cases that these people came because they found my music fascinating and whatever I could provide on the piano as a pianist, interesting. And I remember this little story. I didn't tell you that last time, but when we recorded with Dave Holland, and first the miking wasn't happening on the piano, and then I'm looking at Dave and I said, man, this just don't get the sound what I would like. You think I should change my touch? And then he looks at me, no, don't change your touch. Right. So then I knew that he appreciates my tone and my sound on the piano because he said, no. You are fine. And of course, they got the sound eventually, and we had a very nice session. But these kind of compliments mean a lot to you when you're just starting up.
So you graduated from Berkeley. I think you taught shortly after that, started teaching there.
Mm-hmm.
And you're part of the faculty over there. So what types of things do you teach your students? What do you about your experiences, the different experiences. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's every student has different things that they need to hear, that you can hear what they play and you know, how about listening to this? This can help you, this can add to your vocabulary, that kind of thing.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because when we started to have a website at Berkeley, it was many, many years ago, at Berkeley asked us all to talk about our teaching philosophy. So it's all up there when you go to the Laszlo Gardony
file.
Yes. And that's what I say there pretty much, that I believe that everybody is touched by certain important recordings or concerts as in their formative years. And it's usually not like one person that they try to emulate or copy, but there are various sources of those magical moments that really make you want to be a musician.
And I think that's an important point that you point out there, because a growing, evolving musician always has more than one influence.
Yes, exactly. If that person were to become great,
right,
then they're not going to be a copycat to someone.
That's right.
So
that's
for
right.
me, as a good teacher, first of all, I have to have a panoramic vision of music, and I have to be genuinely interested in all styles of music.
That's right.
And musical expression. And then I have to sense from my work with the students, what are these inspiring pieces of music that I could introduce them to, and then teach them skills and knowledge on those pieces of music. So when they really eventually develop their own voice, it's not the voice that they copy from somebody,
that's
not
right.
even me, because
right.
I certainly
right.
don't want to be the teacher who
right.
is going to be providing their voice by lending mine to them.
Right. It's not, it wouldn't be genuine. So
no, it's not
that.
Genuine at all.
Yeah.
So what you really try to teach them is appreciate those moments when they are really taken by music and emulate that experience and try to grow from there and finding those that material for them.
And shortly after this, you did a thing for Avenue Records.
Oh yeah.
Breakout.
Mm-hmm.
And that, but that was, let's go to Change in Standards. That's
mm-hmm.
the first one. That was in 1990.
Yeah.
It was a solo piano thing called Change in Standards. This
mm-hmm.
was your first one for Sunnyside.
Right.
So what kind of gave you the idea to kind of go in a solo direction
mm-hmm.
and Changing Standards? So kind of, what was the thought process going into that?
Well, you know, if you improvise since you were a kid, you know that you find this incredible strength sometimes by just making stuff up on the spot. Your rhythm is strongest, your expression, your projection is the strongest. So my idea was obviously as a solo piano recording, you have complete freedom with that. So originally I booked maybe 2 hours in the studio at this little studio called Air Sound, which was right behind Berkeley. Just wanted to go in there and play
get
and see
feel,
how it is.
See what it's like, yeah.
Now, that night, everything, all the equipment was malfunctioning. The microphones weren't working. There was a screeching sound in the back. So I told them, okay, I'm not going to pay for this, but really it's kind of sad that I came here and couldn't do any work. So they offered me a free hour a couple of days later. So I went in for that free hour. I had a friend of mine, Kenny Wallison, a drummer, come in with me just for moral support. He got
sure.
some coffee for
yeah.
us in Dunkin' Donuts. And I sat down and I started playing with no preconceived idea what it's going to be. And as it turns out, it was a very inspiring moment or zone, as they call it, I got into, and one standard after the other manifested there with the same spaces as you hear on the record between them in a completely recomposed way. So this is not like reharmonizing standards. This is not like changing the form. And actually it was way ahead of its time in the sense that standards were usually played on the original form with the original idea and then with your own stamp put on it. But this was using the standards as a vehicle to cohabit as a composer. So you compose something out of that standard that somehow connects to the spirit of the standard, but it's a new composition. So that's what happened there spontaneously in that hour that I had. And then a very similar thing happened on the new album, Clarity,
oh, yeah.
that I started improvising
right.
and one thing led to another. No preconceived notion. This Clarity, my 2013 release, turned into a lovely and deeply emotional string of original music.
Right. That's right.
But that time it was all these recomposed standards
right.
that found new forms, find
right.
new shapes
yep.
beyond just reharmonization. So I loved that. And then of course I showed it to Sunnyside, and that's what got me signed to Sunnyside originally.
Then you took a small little break from them and did a thing called Breakout with
yep.
Nick Goodrick and George Shinta, yeah. And there was a bass player and two drummers, that taiko-type drummers,
yeah, percussionist, basically, yeah. Trap drums.
Right. And that was only one session.
That was one session. Yeah, we did it in, I wrote the music very meticulously, everything. I wrote out the bass parts, basically I told the percussion players how to set up the grooves and the guitar parts, but I left, of course, ample solo space for everybody. But then when we went to the studio, it turned into almost like a concert.
Yeah.
It just went so fast and so naturally, and the next day I mixed it and it was done.
Yeah.
And that whole idea came together, first meeting George in New York and becoming friends, and inviting him to Berkeley to play with me and Mick at the Performance Center. So we did a trio concert there. A lot of improvisation, mostly just things that we made up on the spot, was very successful. And then I made the band larger, made it a quintet, and I started to write music for
you. He probably had a specific idea. Let's put this guy really under the microscope, see what he can do as a drummer to see if this could work. So I'm sure it worked out quite well with you.
Yeah, it was lovely because, you know, we made stuff up and we haven't done that with him. We did this kind of work with Mick. I was in several bands with him before.
Right, right.
But there it is. And then I ordered the new Stomu from my original experience as a student with Aaron Scott and Stomu Takesh. So Stomu was the bassist, his brother, who turned out to be a great drummer, also a great taiko drum player. He was the other percussionist. And it was a very united sense of direction in the band. Plus, everything was really nicely written out because this was more of a kind of album that, you know, you have a very clear sense of the forms and everything.
And I think it was received rather well as well.
Right, and it got us major festivals, Kansas City. Yep. We got to play at the corner of 18th and Wine Street. That was the name of the festival, which was the original center of jazz before New Orleans became.
Right, right. And he did this one had a real deep meaning. He did for Akrid a co-leader thing with Garrison Frumo called Reflections of a Clear Moon. It was done in Budapest back in 95.
Right, right.
So you was touring in that area and you just decided to... plus you did something prior to a Garrison on Hackerwood, Cecil McBee.
Yes,
so
that's right.
You had a feeling of what he could do and as a player. And plus the last time you were here, you said he got a grant to go out there. So
that's right. Originally, the way I got to play with Garrison is that he put out an album first with Fred Hirsch, Cecil McBee, Matt Wilson. And when his second album was coming around, then he asked me to join the band, which was the same band minus Fred Hirsch. So I got to play with Cecil McBee, Matt Wilson on his next album, which was titled Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Right, right.
So we became friends, we toured together. Some of it was in duo, more like economical reasons, you know. We went to Canada together, let's play a duo, that's easy to do.
Yeah.
And it started to become really good musical combination as well, not just an economical choice. And then once he was talking about wanting to go to explore the Hungarian scene, I said, okay, let me see what I can do. So I got in touch with an old friend who worked at the radio station. He was the jazz programmer there, actually the director of the jazz programming. And he provided us with a live performing opportunity in the studio that was broadcast live all over the
country.
Around
Hungary,
In Hungary, and also recorded professionally.
Yeah.
So we went there, we had a nice dinner right before, we had some nice conversation, which I remember still being a very friendly moment. And somehow we just clicked just right that we could do things that we have never even done before. There were levels of communication there that really reached a new
height. Yeah, and when I got this CD, this was back in 95, and I've never heard a piano guitar thing before, and I was really captivated by your playing. The energy there was just, it seemed like there was some spontaneity, there was just some very creative playing.
Thanks. I felt very good about that because what we felt is that both of us provided three tunes that we're going to play on. And then we found some new things on each of those, you know, to do there. And it was based on this kind of warmth and mutual trust in each other's music, plus a really close communication. So when that happens, then there is a good chance that something interesting comes out. And it was very interesting because certain things I did there, because some of the parts are solo piano before I bring him in, and he did also solo guitar parts. You know, I was able to kind of surprise myself also with that's good.
Exactly.
There's some of the things from all way back, like some Emerson, Lake and Palmer influences came back in,
right.
Some progressive rock things came in, which is funny because Garrison officially was a bebop influence player at the time. Later he moved into free jazz.
Yep.
That was great. And everybody just turned a new leaf, him, myself, and we connected over that. Yeah.
And you did a recording for Sunnyside called Behind Open Doors.
Mm-hmm.
You had a drummer, Jimmy Haddad, and John Lockwood. So he was with you for a little while.
Yeah.
I'm sure that was a good, this is a very good record.
Thanks.
Very good record.
I felt very good about that band. We had a very nice, inspiring relationship with Jamie. He was a very compassionate person, you know, he would secure grants for Indian musicians to come over and be able to stay in New York and participate in the scene. He would bring people over, mostly from India, to Berkeley also to do some presentations when he started teaching there. So there was this level of love of music and also the love of real talent in music that we connected over, which I feel the same way. So. When we started playing it, at that point, it just started to feel like a telepathic kind of connection. And then with John, I played many years before, mostly at the beginning when he was subbing for Dave Holland. Of course, Dave Holland wasn't available for touring, but the album was out with him. So we toured with John, and we played in Bob Moses's band. So we did all kind of things with John before. And when these two guys were put together with me, then we created this music. Partially, I wrote very specific things for the session. Some of them were derived from improvisations I had before, but I wrote out everything. And some of them were happening right there. Like the first tune, it was improvised on the spot.
Right.
The arrangement for Around Midnight was improvised on the spot. I was suggesting certain things, and it just went from there. And everything else was written. There is a beautiful piece of Hungarian folk music. I worked quite hard on that one. The March of 1848,
Exactly. And then after that, I think you told me that he went on tour with Paul Simon. And then Yaron Israel came into the band. So this CD, Before Ever...
Ever Before Ever After.
After. Yeah, with Yaron Israel and John Lockwood.
Right.
Early 2000s. Natural Instinct and Ding Deep. And Signature Times. One of these was recorded at GBH Studio.
Right.
And you were telling me that in 2002 or 2003, John Lockwood just got off the plane from Turkey.
That's right.
Had to do that performance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he came straight to the studio from the airport. And by then I realized, because Yaron started subbing for Jamie first in my band, and Jamie was going out on the road with Paul Simon, that we have a very special connection with Yaron, plus I really appreciated the sincerity of his writing as a composer and his drumming, and I really connected to these deep roots that he has in music, the way he connects to gospel, the way he connects to the blues, the way he connects to modern jazz, and modern jazz that I like, not just you know, things that I would respect, but genuinely like. He would like the same things. So it was a great opportunity, but it was still, you know, something that could have gone either way. It was a radio show with interview segments between the pieces. He just learned my music.
Yeah.
You know, I wrote out new things. There was a session with all new material. But you never know, especially when the bass player could be falling asleep for all we know at the bass after a major trip from Turkey. And once the music started going there, that was the first sign for me that this trio will be around for a long time. If it's up to me,
right.
I'm gonna keep them together because this is really special.
And the last tour you did was Signature Time in 2011, and the latest Clarity in 2013. Signature Time had Stan Strickland, a saxophonist, on it, and he's a very interesting player in himself. And your latest one, Clarity, is a solo one, and it had a very special meaning with parent passing away and stuff. So, this one got a lot of good feedback, Clarity, because you were telling me a guy who writes for Candace Records. Publication said he was having a bad day and he listened to that record and he said his his stress was gone, which is quite a thing.
That's what you want to have, hearing from your fans. But in the same time, since we met, also it got me opportunities to play in solo a lot, and I was invited just recently to New York City to play in a new series, the New Directions in Solo Piano series, and I got a wonderful concert review in Downbeat, which just came out. So I got the recognition that I feel very good about for my ability to create music on the spot and also to breathe new life into things that I either previously wrote.